London is well known for its historic heritage. It's a city with numerous buildings of historic importance. In the London area of Southfields is a building that is of historic importance not only for London, but for Islam as a religion.
Ye masjid Fazl jo ab daimi fazlon ka hai munba isi masjid ke daman se hi chashmae baqa nikla Masjid Fazl Masjid Fazl Masjid Fazl Masjid Fazl
The Holy Messenger of Islam, Prophet Muhammad, may peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, was commanded right from the start that he must spread the divine message of Allah the Almighty to the corners of the earth. The areas that came under the flag of Islam are a proof that Islam spread rapidly within its first century. However, the Holy Prophet, may peace be upon him, had prophesied that my century will be the best century, then the next, and then the one after that. He had prophesied too that Islam will undergo a phase of decline, with many sects being formed. Out of all, only one sect shall be on the right path, and this one only would be the sect of the righteous. Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian claimed to be the promised Messiah and Mahdi, about whom the Holy Founder of Islam had foretold. He was born in 1835 and announced his claim in 1882 according to revelations, visions, and dreams which he had received from Allah the Almighty. During his life, he received many revelations from Allah about future events, some of which have been fulfilled, while some are yet to be fulfilled in their time.
Huzur Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam had made a prophecy that in the latter days, that is the time of the Prophet Messiah and Imam Mahdi, the sun will rise from the west. The Prophet Messiah was asked about this prophecy, and he explained that we also believe in this prophecy, but what has been revealed to me through a vision, that is that the sun which will rise from the west, it only means that the sun of Islam will rise from the west.
Here I would like to mention a dream of the promised Messiah Islam, where he was shown in the vision that he is in London, he's standing on a pulpit, he is delivering a speech about Islam.
And he was delivering a speech in English. And he has written there that he was giving strong arguments, very impressive arguments regarding the truth of Islam.
And he mentioned that as a result of his preaching, he was able to capture certain birds, several birds. They were white in color and very small in size. They were sitting on small trees around him. So that was a clear indication that by the grace of Allah, the message of Ahmadiyya, the message of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, is going to be spread and it is going to be accepted by several people.
And the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, himself has interpreted this dream or in the vision that although he is not able to visit England, but his writings will reach England, and the message of Islam and Ahmadiyyat will reach the corners of the earth from England.
So the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam started his mission with this objective in mind, and he was very, very keen really to see that the message goes in all parts of the world.
These dreams and visions for Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salatu wasalam, the promised Messiah, were of more value than glad tidings only. He took them to be signals from God Almighty that his message should be extended to the West. And this he did with great zeal and enthusiasm. He knew that he was a Messiah appointed not only for a certain geographic area, but for the whole world.
It is narrated that once the promised Messiah ﷺ was sitting in his house, the door was locked, somebody knocked at the door. There was another person who stood up to open the door, and then he brought the message that there is somebody at the door who would like to convey a very important message to the promised Messiah, who was very busy at that time. But still he admitted that person to him, had to come in. And the gentleman conveyed the message that I had a discussion with someone, and I just refuted all the allegations. I gave this argument and that, all the details were mentioned. The promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam listened to him very carefully, and after he has finished, he said, you have narrated whatever you have done, but with the force of your banging and knocking at the door, I had thought that perhaps you have brought the news that the whole of Europe has been converted to Islam. So that was his desire.
On 22nd of June, 1897, Queen Victoria held her Diamond Jubilee, and it was celebrated by the United Kingdom and the rest of the British Empire. And on this occasion, the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, wrote a letter to the Queen in the form of a booklet, which was named Tohfa-e Kaisriya, a present to the Empress.
And that book was sent to the Queen, in which the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, very openly invited the Queen, describing the good points of freedom of speech and establishment of peace under her rule. He pointed out that the real message of Islam should be accepted in order to achieve real peace.
In this book, Hazrat Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam explained the true position and status of Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam and said that he was a true prophet of God and no more than that. And it would be most improper to call Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam as an accursed person. He also explained what Islamic Jihad really meant and how it was different from what people generally think of it. He also presented a suggestion in the same book to the Queen of holding a conference of world religions in London, which would familiarize people of England with the true teachings of Islam.
The promised Messiah was told beforehand that the true message of Islam will eventually reach the Western countries and will save many from Satan's spell. Utilizing all available resources, the promised Messiah kept sending his message to the world. His books, pamphlets, and tracts are still held in the archives of the British Library. He told the world that he had been sent only to sow a seed. A seed that will grow into a grand tree in the time of his successors.
The life of the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam is full of such examples which show his keen dedication to the spread of the message of Ahmadiyya to all parts of the world, particularly to the European countries. This continued, and well after his demise, the system of Khilafat started in the community. This point of conveying the message all over the world that continued to remain the topmost priority of all the caliphs who succeeded him.
He passed away on the 26th of May, 1908. Thereafter, upon the precepts of prophethood, the community unanimously elected Hazrat Maulvi Nuruddin Raziullah Ta'ala Anhu as the first successor of the promised Messiah. During his tenure, the community took its first step outside of Qadian. Hazrat Maulvi Nuruddin, may Allah be pleased with him, sent Hazrat Chaudhry Fateh Muhammad Siyal, a prominent companion of the promised Messiah, to England to start a new mission and to propagate the true message of Islam to the West.
The missionary work in the United Kingdom, it started with the arrival of the first missionary and it continued. And these missionaries, they were stationed in various places. They did not have a proper headquarter to work from. But still, with their dedication and zeal, the work continued. And those missionaries, they worked very hard and conveyed the message in all the ways possible for them. But later on, with the establishment of the mosque, naturally, it was a much better place to start the whole campaign from, because mosque is not only a place of worship, it is the center of all the activities and the center of tabligh of the Jamaat.
A mission is of great importance for preaching and propagating a message, but a mosque has a vital role in creating a feeling of attachment and affiliation, a pivotal role in enhancing the spiritual side of one's being. Similarly, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community now felt the need for a mosque outside of Qadian. If the community was to expand, it had to aim at every part of the world, the pinnacle being the West.
The tariq to build a mosque in Berlin was announced by Hazrat Muslim Maud Raziallahu Ta'ala Anhu, and he addressed the Lajna Imaila and requested them to collect the finances for building a mosque in Berlin. Hazrat Muslim Maud Raziallahu Ta'ala Anhu could foresee the importance of Berlin, the strategic geographical importance of Berlin, because a mosque in Berlin would be a gateway to the east of whole Europe, USSR, and as much as all the other countries that are lying in the east.
The ladies had contributed 75,000 rupees for the Berlin mosque. But the council, city council of Berlin, they asked the Jamaat to build a mosque according to their own plan. And if we had followed that plan, Jamaat had to spend 1.5 million rupees at that time. So the Khalifa Sani radiallahu ta'ala anhu decided that we are not in a position, financially speaking, to spend so much money.
Therefore, the mosque in Berlin couldn't be built in Berlin. And for that reason, Hazrat Muslim Maud radiallahu ta'ala anhu addressed once again the Lajna and said or suggested that the money that has been collected for the Berlin mosque could be used for a mosque to be built in the United Kingdom.
Nowadays, when the groups of visitors, they come to see the mosque, I always tell them one thing very special about the London mosque, and that is that all the funds for the building of the mosque, they were contributed primarily, basically, by the ladies of the community.
Despite the fact that the funds now had been collected by the Lajna, mashallah, and the blueprints and everything that was needed to build the mosque was ready, the financial circumstances in Germany were not in favor of building a mosque there at that time. And therefore, the plan had been changed, and instead of building a mosque in Germany, in Berlin, in London, a mosque was feasible.
One of the main ambitions of Hazrat Muslim Maud radiallahu ta'ala anhu was to establish a mosque in London, because London being the center of Christianity and in a way center of the world, we can say, it was a very important place. So Hazrat Muslim Maud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he decided that in order to make a central place for the preaching of the message of Islam in four corners of the earth, we have to establish a center in London. So for this purpose, he sent Hazrat Chaudhry Fateh Muhammad Sahib Sial for the second time in 1919 back to London. And the main task allocated to him was that you should try to look around for a suitable place for this mosque. It is recorded in history that Hazrat Chaudhry Sahib was able to find a very good piece of land, actually that place where the mosque stands today. This place was acquired, the price was reasonable, but the only snag was that it was a bit out of London. So Hazrat Muslim Maud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he immediately sent a message, yes, immediately go ahead and buy it. If you consider this place to be out of London at this moment, a time would come when London would be coming here. So it would become really the part of London, and that's very much so. So that place was found by Hazrat Chaudhry Fateh Muhammad Sahib Sial in 1919, very soon after the task was given to him, and he purchased this piece of land in 1920.
Hazrat Chaudhry Fateh Muhammad Sahib Sial, who was a companion of the promised Messiah, is the founder of the UK Ahmadiyya Muslim Mission. He was instructed by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu to look for a plot where a mosque could be built. Hazrat Chaudhry Sahib found this plot at 63 Melrose Road. It consisted of an acre of land with a house, three-story building, and he purchased it for £2,300.
Then the next step was to lay the foundation of the mosque. So the whole process continued, and in 1924, by the grace of Allah, the foundation of the mosque was laid on 19th of October 1924 by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II, Raziyallahu ta'ala anhu, by himself. Because when that occasion came, after consultation with the members of the Jamaat, he decided to come himself, because his presence would definitely create a great impact, and that's exactly what happened.
In 1924, the second successor of the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, Raziyallahu ta'ala anhu, and 12 of his most prominent companions arrived in England for the Conference on Living Religions of the Empire, or commonly known as the Wembley Conference.
Hazrat Muslim Maud arrived in the United Kingdom in 1924 with dual purpose. One, to attend the opening of or the laying of the foundation stone of the London Mosque, and the other was to attend the proceedings and to deliver an address at the Religions of the Empire Wembley Conference. This was a very important conference in which a number of religions were represented, and there was a great deal of media coverage both prior to the conference and also once it following it, and a great deal of emphasis in all the coverage was on the great speech of Hazrat Muslim Maud. I'll just briefly speak about that. The Evening Standard in August 1924, on the 23rd of August 1924, said, "His Holiness the Khalifatul Masih, head of the Ahmadiyya movement in Islam, has arrived in London with about a dozen secretaries. He explained the object of his mission westward."
The foundation stone of Masjid Fazl London was laid by Hazrat Muslim Maud Radhiyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, the second Khalifa, on 19th of October 1924. The time was fixed at 3 p.m. The weather was extremely bad. So the Khalifa Sani was reported that Huzoor, weather is very bad. And since the election of the UK were also nearing, they were taking place only after 4 days. So everybody was worried that whether the guest would be able to arrive or not. Huzoor said, "The weather is bad and I am happy that only those people will arrive who will come with pure intention to attend this blessed event."
There was a large gathering at the London Mosque. It was widely publicized by the British press. Even the Times gave the news, and so many other newspapers published the news of the opening, of the laying of the foundation of the London Mosque ceremony. Mayors, MPs, lords, and ambassadors of various countries, Maharaja of Bardwan, and so many other dignitaries were present on this particular occasion. Huzoor laid the foundation stone of the mosque. Hazrat Maulana Dard Sahib and some other missionaries were also present. And the full entourage of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II, who came with him from India, were also here. After the laying of the foundation stone, there was a prayer, silent prayer led by Hazrat Amirul Mumineen, and then a short speech in which Huzoor said that this mosque is mainly for the Muslims and Ahmadis, but its doors are open to anybody who would like to come here and worship one God. This was an announcement that he made, and he said this is following the tradition of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who gave the permission to a delegation of Najran Christians to have their worship in Masjid Nabawi.
There was a number of newspapers, both nationally and regionally, that covered this event. Nationally speaking, the Daily Express, which is a very well-known newspaper in the United Kingdom, and continues to this day, cover the event and spoke about how the leader of the Ahmadiyya Jamaat had arrived in London. The Daily Chronicle, which was a regional newspaper, which at the time was quite well known, well regarded, also reported on the event and said that Hazrat Muslim Maud the head of the Ahmadiyya Jamaat had laid the stone, and it also reported about the size of the Jamaat and how many countries it had established itself in. And also it impressed on its readers the many dignitaries who had come from both the United Kingdom, from Western Europe, from Eastern Europe, from Japan, from America, I believe, and a number of other countries as well. And so that gave very good coverage. And also the Westminster Gazette, this also covered in detail the opening of the mosque. It said that it was the first purpose-built mosque in the United Kingdom.
The wishes of Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, Raziyallahu ta'ala anhu, were now becoming a reality. The media remained in touch with the progress of the community and continued to do so throughout 1924, 1925, and 1926. The mosque was now ready. All members of the community were excited and thrilled. They had so lovingly, wholeheartedly donated for this mosque. Donations were not only of monetary nature. Donations had been made of time, of wealth, of effort, of labor, and, of course, in the form of prayers. So it deserved a grand opening.
When the time came for the actual opening of the Fazl Mosque in 1926, the missionary in charge, Maulvi Abdul Rahim Dard Sahib, M.A., requested the guidance of Hazrat Muslim Maud as to who should open the mosque.
So instructed Hazrat Maulana Dard Sahib, who is the first Imam of the London Mosque, to request King Saud of Saudi Arabia to send one of his sons to London for the opening ceremony. This request was made, and the king readily accepted the invitation.
And he sent Prince Faisal to London specifically for this task. Prince Faisal at the time was the governor of Hijaz, one of the main provinces in the then Arabia. And when he arrived in London, as per the traditions of the Jamaat, he was given a great welcome by the Imam of the London Mosque and the other MDs.
King of the Hijaz, Ibn Saud, was invited to this august occasion. He appointed his son, Shah Faisal, to represent him and attend this event. However, for some strange reason, the prince, who had travelled to London solely for this purpose, called to say he could not attend.
However, as the days passed before the opening of the mosque, there was some confusion. Prince Faisal suddenly started to lose contact with the Jamaat and wasn't returning a number of the messages of the Imam of the mosque. And because of this, Dard Sahib became somewhat apprehensive.
But in the meantime, the opponents of the Ahmadiyya movement approached the king, and they said to the king that the second Khalifa had announced that the doors of the mosque will be open for anybody who wants to worship God. So therefore, it's not particularly a mosque. This is a place of worship for everybody. Well, this was one of the reasons. They gave other reasons also, and they said that the Muslims generally do not are in favor of the Ahmadis.
There was some reaction to the non-attendance of Prince Faisal. Some non-Ahmadi groups tried to play it as an embarrassment for the Jamaat. However, the whole controversy actually worked out in favor of the Jamaat, because the Jamaat at the time was a very small, not very small, but a relatively small organization, and it needed wider publicity. But the whole, and this whole event, the fact that Prince Faisal was coming, and then the fact that he chose not to come, gave it a great deal of publicity, and a lot of people became aware of the Jamaat who would otherwise not have done so.
So, while all the preparations were being done, and the prince was even interviewed by some of the newspapers here, he received a telegram from his father not to take part in the ceremony.
This was an issue arising at the last minute and had to be dealt with immediately. The opening was only a few hours away when it was confirmed that the son of Ibn Saud would not attend due to his father's orders. The then Imam, Hazrat Maulana Abdul Rahim Dard, sent a telegram to His Holiness that this is the case, what should be done? The second successor immediately replied that the ceremony should go ahead with the same spirit and same zeal.
Sheikh Abdul Qadir, who was the president of the Legislative Assembly of Punjab and was here in connection with the meeting of the League of Nations. He had already been requested that if something happens, will you kindly do the ceremony? He said, I'm a liberal man, although I'm a Muslim, and I'm a liberal man. I don't believe in what the Maulvis are saying, and I will happily do it. Again, there was a very huge gathering here outside the London Mosque. And the Hazrat, not only this, but it was filmed by the Pathé film, and which is available now. Hazrat Maulana Dard Sahib gave the key of the mosque to Sheikh Abdul Qadir Sahib, who turned the key and opened the mosque, and the first prayer was held at the London Mosque. The azan was given by two people. Number one was Hazrat Malik Ullah Farid Sahib, who was the deputy imam here. He gave the azan on behalf of all the Ahmadis all over the world and the Eastern people. And Mr. Nuttall, who was an English Muslim, Ahmadi, very enthusiastic. I met him several times, and he was a good friend of mine. He gave the azan on behalf of the English people, and that is why he was given the name of Bilal then. The name was Mr. Hawker Nuttall. So Bilal was added to it, and from then on he was known as Bilal Nuttall.
And despite the non-attendance of Prince Faisal, still a number of newspapers covered the event as well. I'll just give you a couple of examples. On the 4th of October 1926, the Daily Chronicle wrote a very inspiring write-up of the event, and actually said that the East and West had come together for the first time through the opening of the London Mosque, and that it was in the long history of London, it was the first time that the azan, that is the call to prayer, had been heard so loudly and so publicly. In Wales, one of their main national newspapers, the South Wales News, also covered the event. The Northern Echo wrote in detail about the comments made by Sir Abdul Qadir as he opened the mosque, and he said where he said that the opening of any mosque, regardless of which sect or which community it belonged to, was a very important event, and that was why he was there, even though he knew that back in India, there were certain groups who did not approve or see the Ahmadiyya Jamaat as a Muslim organization.
Everybody who looks at the press coverage of those days, one can realize that that was really a turning point in the history of Ahmadiyya Jamaat, because it was a very important occasion which brought to light the message of Islam, and people really started taking interest. We can see in pictures the crowds of such people who are gathered in the area of the mosque to attend the ceremony, to listen to the meetings and the speeches delivered on that occasion.
This mosque proved to be of significant value, not only for the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, but for all Muslims. It also proved to be of immense importance to the British culture, which was, in the following decades, to become the most culturally and religiously diverse society of the world. This mosque is right in the heart of materialism, the heart of the modern world, London. Being the first mosque outside of Qadian, the village of the Promised Messiah, it had the prayers of the Promised Reformer, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, may Allah be pleased with him. It also had the prayers of many companions of the Promised Messiah, on whom be peace, and prominent members of the community. As a matter of fact, the entire community were looking forward to the immense roles this mosque would play in the times to come.
If we look generally at the activities of the missionaries in that early period of the history of Ahmadiyyat in this country, then we know that they did everything possible for them at that time. Generally, the message of Islam was conveyed through one-to-one sittings, talking to their people, maybe on the roadside, maybe in the parks, maybe in the libraries or other meeting places. And also, one prominent aspect of that was the lectures in various clubs and associations. So that was a very popular way where people wanted to listen. And by the grace of Allah, the missionaries at that time they fully utilized this occasion, and it is recorded in the history that the lectures in societies, clubs, schools, colleges, and in some cases in Rotary clubs, all these things, they were very common in those days, and that was the main way of conveying the message of Islam. Along with that, the publication of literature, small leaflets, some books and booklets, they were also made available. And at a later period in history, some regular publications, they were also started. So distribution of these things, that was also done. And the missionaries, they utilized all the occasions which was available to them at that time. If we have to recount and mention the names of those pioneer missionaries, I have got a brief list of those names with me, which I would like to share. And first and foremost was Chaudhary Fateh Muhammad Sahib Sial, the first missionary who arrived here. Then Hazrat Qazi Muhammad Abdullah Sahib, Hazrat Dr. Mufti Muhammad Sadiq Sahib, a very prominent missionary of the Jamaat. Then Hazrat Maulvi Abdul Rahim Nayyar Sahib, who worked here as well, and also in Africa later on. And Hazrat Khan Sahib, Farzand Ali Khan Sahib. Then Hazrat Maulana Abdul Rahim Dard Sahib. And then Hazrat Maulana Jalaluddin Sahib Shams. These are the missionaries who worked in the early history of the community here in this country. And all these missionaries, it is very important and very worth noting point that these pioneer missionaries of the Ahmadiyya Jamaat in this country, they had the good fortune of being the companion of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam. So one can see that these people, and I forgot to mention one name of Hazrat Maulana Shirki Sahib. He was also a companion of the promised Messiah. He had the honor of translating the Holy Quran into English. Most of the job was done here. So all these people, all these fortunate people who had the good honor of being the companion of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, they actually made their mark during their stay in this country. So this mission can be very proud that the pioneer missionary in this country who worked day and night on this soil, they happen to be the companions of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam.
One should remember that this is the first mosque of London. Some people are mistaken to mention that another mosque existed at that time in Woking. That was not in London. Woking is in the suburbs of London. So this was sheer blessing and grace of Allah Ta'ala that he enabled Ahmadiyya Muslim Association, a very humble community, to build this house, first house of Allah in London, in Putney or Wandsworth area.
Another important aspect of the central position of the London Mosque is that it practically became the center of our tabligh activities for the whole world, particularly for the European countries.
In the eyes of the public, this mosque was a very humble mosque, and it wasn't thought that this mosque had such a high status in the eyes of Allah the Almighty. No one was aware of the plans which Allah had for this mosque.
When this mosque was built, there were only a few Indian students, Ahmadi Indian students, who would come to the mosque, not on a very regular basis, because they had their universities and everything, but on a Friday, there may be four or five people who would come to the mosque for their prayer service.
The families were also few, so what we used to do was ladies also used to say Juma within Fazl Mosque. And we only used to get about a dozen ladies, so for them, we used to put a curtain and leave a place for about a dozen ladies, and the ladies used to say Juma there.
So the financial condition was naturally not very good, because the chanda was not that much, and mostly they were student, so they couldn't afford to give large amounts of chanda. The highest chanda paid was English Ahmadi, Mr. Summers. His chanda was at one time £19 per month, and we thought this was a huge amount that he was giving to the mosque every month, because nobody paid that much chanda in those days per month. So the problem was that this mosque had heaters, but they were, it was not centrally heating. It was just heaters. There were six heaters, gas heaters. and it would take a long, long time to heat it up. The other problem was that there was a carpet donated by the Hyderabad Dakkan Jamaat in 1924, which was still lying here, and there was nothing, no underlay. So the thing was that it used to be so cold because of the cement thing that it was very difficult, and the people would come and on a Juma, they will sit scattered, you know, near the heaters. But in winters, it was not possible for us to carry on our prayers into the mosque, because number one, it was very expensive. Number two, it was very cold here. And number three, there were not many people. So usually, we will lock this mosque in November and shift to 63 Melrose Road, and we will have our prayers there. And then in Easter week, we'll reopen it. And then the problem would be that because it was closed for all this time and because of cold, the distemper which was on the wall, it will fall down and the whole carpet would be full of this. And in those days there were no hoovers, so it will take 2 or 3 days to clear the area, the carpet from this. And on, I remember on two occasions at least, we did we had our Eid prayers in the open, because there were about 10 people or 15 people who came here for their Eid prayer service. And we thought there's no use doing it in the mosque, why not do it outside?
In 1924, when Hazrat Muslim Maud arrived here, he, apart from laying the foundation stone of the mosque, he held a meeting of the missionaries at that time. And in that, the discussion took place as to how effectively we can convey the message of Islam to other countries. And this continued to be a one important task to be carried out from the London Mosque. Later on, a stage came during the period of Maulana Jalaluddin Sahib Shams that 12 missionaries, well-trained and qualified, all wearing green turbans, they left Qadian and they were sent to London so that they can have some sort of practical experience of tabligh, also some training and some more experience they can gain. And after that, these 12 missionaries, they were deputed to various countries in Europe.